Okay, everybody. Welcome to this Tilton Library Program, which is taking place here in Deerfield Town Hall. As many of you know, we don't have a place at the library. I had to get that in. I'm Sarah Woodbury. I'm the library director for the Town of Deerfield Public Library. This program is the last program in our Deerfield Reads community reading program. It's sponsored in part by the Deerfield Cultural Council, which is a local agency supported by the Massachusetts Cultural Council, a state agency. It's also sponsored by the Friends of Tilton Library and by Greenfield Cooperative Bank. Tonight's program features Barry Deitz. He lives in Bernardson. He was formerly from North Carolina. He's been here for 2 years, and he's done this program in libraries throughout the area to great success, and I can see that there's some interest here. Barry is here today, but in the past, he's worked for many bookstores and libraries, and he's presented over 100 programs ranging from poetry of World War I to the life and times of Lewis Carroll. He has a degree in English, and over the years has been a book reviewer, a radio announcer, a television show host, a high school teacher, manager of a classical music store, TV news anchor, community theater actor, poet, and documentary filmmaker. So I have a feeling he gets a lot of stuff, he gathers a lot of information, and he this is one of many show talks that he gives. So maybe we'll have him back to tell us other stories. Last summer, he traveled across the country working on a film about Bigfoot, and he's recently done programs on Charles Dickens and Bram Stoker's Dracula. So this is going to be an exciting program. I've heard it's great, and we're really happy to have Barry Deitz here. Come on over, Barry, and show your face.
Well, good evening. Thank you for coming out. I was a little worried earlier on. Lots of bad rainy weather, and you never know what's going to happen. Thank you for coming out and hearing me tonight. The first question, obviously, she explained. Where is he from? I'm from North Carolina. I moved here 2 years ago. And the question, of course, really is, why is a guy from the South up here talking about Interstate 91? Well, there's a story to that I'm going to unfold for you this evening. This is a story of my adventure to learn more about where I live and what it's like to be up here. And I absolutely stumbled onto this story that I'm going to tell you. But out of curiosity, my love of history, I'm not a historian. I'm not a reporter. I'm a storyteller. And I love stories, and I want to share stories with you about this journey that I have been on. I've been up here about 4 months, and I've done a program at Greenfield Library, and someone came up after me and they said, would you come and do a program for the Pioneer Valley Institute? I said, I'd love to. What's the Pioneer Valley? She said, you live in it. Welcome. And I thought, well, I don't really know anything about that, but let me think about that if an idea comes up. And she said, well, why don't you do a program about what it's like to be a Southerner who has moved up into New England? And I thought, well, okay, I could do something with that. And she asked, you said, well, what's the most unique thing? What's so different for you here from living in the South where you live? And I knew immediately my answer. I said, Interstate 91 is different. I grew up along Interstate 95. When you're on Interstate 85, going through Charlotte and going to Raleigh. And when you're on those roads, the next exit's always a mile and a half away. And so when I'm riding around up here and I see the sign, you know, exit 25, and under that little floating panel that says next exit 14 miles. And it's 14 miles of trees. And I had never seen anything quite like that. I had never seen a road that went through such a rural area. And the farms running right up to the edge of the road. And I thought, that's interesting. And then I had a conversation with a man over in Greenfield about the Highway 91. He said, my dad hated Highway 91. He hated the interstate. He hated when he came through. And I said, well, what did he hate about it? And I'm expecting to hear he hated because he lost a lot of his land to it. Or his farm was sliced in half, as many of them were. So that 40 acres of your land's on the other side of the four-lane road now, with no way to get to it. Or I thought maybe the house had been moved. One of the first things they did was shift a lot of the houses around. There's a house that was picked up, moved all the way across the valley, spun around, and set back down. So it's the same house, but now the view's on the other end of the valley, looking in the other direction. And so I'm expecting that. And he says, no, no, no. My dad hated 91 because he lost all of his fishing holes to it. Because he fished along the Falls River. And the Falls River was relocated, as they put it, four times. And you know he was right when you looked on the topographical map. You could see that before 91 came through, it was a wormy little river with all those bends and curves, wonderful fishing places. Afterwards, they had straightened it out completely. And I thought, who would have thought of that? I mean, who would have thought that the building of a highway means a bunch of guys lose their fishing hole? Maybe there is something to this. And then it was after that when I was talking to a local historian about, he did an oral history on this area. And he said, I was asking, he's bedridden. And so I was interviewing him. And he was laying there, and the man who helps him every morning, who's known each other, they've known each other for 50 years. And they're sitting there every morning. And I asked him, I said, what's the number one thing? If I was to ask you, tell me one thing that changed drastically with the building of I-91, what would it be? And he said it would be the catastrophic effect on businesses on Route 5, many of which never recovered. But before I could even get that written down, the other man said, oh no, it was wonderful when 91 came through. It was so much easier to get to Vermont for the skiing. And I thought, well, there's the story. That's progress, isn't it? Things get taken away and erased, and other things get built and recreated. There are places you can't fish anymore, but you can have a dinner of Thai food. There are places you can't go ice skating anymore because the pond was filled in and covered up with a highway. But you can buy a lot of candles around here. And so that's what I want to look at. The story of the progress. What changed and what was different? Now, I've done this program all around. I've done this up in Berniston. I did it down in Longmeadow. I've done it in Shelburne Falls. Next week, I'm doing it over in Northampton. But doing it in Deerfield is different. I have a way I start this program. I'm talking about the history of the road, and I'm going to do all that. And I'm going to put it all in the context of the building of the interstate highway system as a whole, because this was happening all across the country. And it's a story that I just fell in love with. It's incredible. You know, some people tell you that the only man-made thing visible from outer space is the Great Wall of China. That's not true. The interstate system in the United States is visible from space. And is also man-made. It is the largest public works program in human history, is the building of these highways. So I'm going to put 91 in the context of all of that. So ordinarily, I would start out with some of that. But you know what? For you folks here in Deerfield tonight, you got to start here. You got to start here. I tried to find a picture of him smiling, but there weren't many. And this one just seems more appropriate. This, of course, is Frank Boyden. For, wait for it, 66 years, the headmaster at Deerfield Academy. So when I started inquiring about, well, what are the stories about 91? Oh, the number one story was of Frank Boyden and the phone call that changed the route of the highway. And I thought, really? And that's what everyone says. And then I picked up the headmaster, John McPhee's little book on it. Now, McPhee puts exactly one sentence to this. He's talking about Boyden up in New York, up in Washington, reconnecting with all the senators he knows and all the congressmen he knows and all the major people he knows. And then McPhee, this was originally a New Yorker piece expanded into this short book. And then he writes, the headmaster recently moved a proposed alignment for an interstate highway with a flick of his elbow. So we have a magic phone call and a magic elbow changing the road. Well, how much of this is true? Well, I want to take you through some correspondence I came across in a file at Deerfield Academy between Frank Boyden and Carl Sheridan, who was the commissioner for Public Works. And I think it's interesting because it sheds some really interesting light on the building of the highway and some of the issues that are going to come up all through it. And so what I'm going to do, first of all, is share some of this correspondence with you. And I'll read these to you because I realize these are too small to read. But I want to read this to you. This is the earliest thing I could find. This is from June of 1957. Now, construction on 91, actual physical construction, began at the tippy ends, at the border between here and Vermont and the border between Massachusetts and Connecticut, in late 58. Okay, so we're long before anything's being made. Construction for the Highway 91 as a whole would take up 12 years. It would not be completed until 1970. But he is writing to the Commissioner of Public Works. This is Frank Boyden. And he writes, "I have just learned that a meeting will be held tomorrow to consider a relocation of Route 5 and 10 as a limited access road. Many in Deerfield are very much concerned about this and would like to endorse the program, which will be presented to you by the Selectmen, the official Total Planning Board and Chamber of Commerce of Greenfield. If possible, before a final decision is made, we would appreciate very much a chance to talk with you about the effect this would have on Deerfield, which we have been making a real effort to preserve as a typical New England village of pre-revolutionary period." In other words, he's making the argument for historical preservation, and this is one of the earliest accounts of anyone doing that. One of the things the building of the high school, the interstate system did, was make people aware of the historical value of places. This is the first major overhauling across the country of the landscape. And this is one of the earliest instances of someone standing up and saying, this is a place of historical value. Now we're used to that kind of things. Now any building you do, they're building a casino down in Springfield. One building, and the historical environmental impact report on that one building was 800 pages long. That's the kind of work you've got to do today. In 1957, most people were not thinking like this. And so I think this is a marvelous example of someone early on getting in the idea of the historical importance of these buildings and this area. So this is Sheridan's response to that. And I'm not going to quote it all, but he says here, "It was very nice receiving your letter in June 26, 1957. And then he goes on to say down here, "I wish to assure you again that it is legally impossible for this department to make a decision on any route for a highway without first having a public hearing." So a lot of worries are already being done. He chides the Assistant Commissioner Dole. This is Fred B. Dole, the Assistant Commissioner, who will be very important from Shelburne as this progress goes on. But I want to show you the kind of dialogue that's going on between officials and stuff like that, that Fred Boyden is getting in there early on and making a case for why it should be preserved. And here again, I'm just going to quote this middle paragraph. This is Boyden back to Sheridan saying, "I do not wish to impose on our friendship in any way, and my desire is only to be helpful and to cooperate in the location of Route 5, if you wish." Now, they're calling it Route 5 because it wasn't until about February of 1958 that it got an actual name of I-91. At this point, it was just the relocation of the new, and sometimes it'll be called the new Route 5. And so it shows that I think the whole area, because this is about the same time you start getting the first artist conceptions of what this is going to look like. The first maps begin to appear in newspapers showing the proposed route. So it's just now the kind of the engines of creating this are all getting started. And this is about a meeting that's going to happen a little later. "I have informed by my survey department," this is Sheridan again, the commissioner, "that they will have some proposed location plans available in July 18th of 1957. And so this was the first actual publication of the route. So in other words, Boyden knew beforehand about some of the route. And so this is the first announcement that I have found. This is from the August 1957 AAA submits Route 5 proposals to state officials. And right here, I'll read this to you. It lists the proposed route for 91 through Deerfield. It says that the proposed route would then pick up, it's tracing the whole route, the abandoned railroad line of West Hatfield and continue northward along the right of way through Whately and South Deerfield to a point just north of the present Route 116, where it would swing in a northwesterly direction on an L Road grade towards Stillwater Bridge and West Deerfield. Now, Boyden reads this and writes these. This is the last letter I'm going to do, so we'll be done with these letters. But I wanted to read this to you because he writes, after reading the first public announcement of the proposed route for the road, he writes, "The other matter which interests me is the outline of the proposed route for the relocation of number 5 in the Pioneer Valley. We in Deerfield are very hopeful that it will not be the one originally laid out, but will go through West Deerfield rather than through Old Deerfield." So, the original plan presumably had taken the road. If you look on a map, you can see that Route 5 and the way 91 runs now are very, very close to one another. Right here you get near Deerfield, and then it splits away, goes around Deerfield, and then hooks back up at 2 and the big roundabout in Greenfield. So the question was, where was that split going to happen? When was 91 going to move further west to miss Deerfield? And that, I suspect, is our phone call. This is his official attempts to get something done about it. But also, I think he had a lot of power. And his argument about the pre-revolutionary town being preserved, I think carried real weight. As the highway system progresses through the 1960s, there begins to be a backlash against these roads, against what's being shifted, what's being changed. I'm going to share a lot of stories with you about how people's lives were affected by these roads coming through. But early on, most town meetings, there was a sense of, well, this is what the government's doing. They're coming through here. It's all for our future. And you don't get a lot of... I went back to some of these early meetings expecting fierce rebellion against the idea of these roads. But in a lot of cases, that was not what happened. A lot of the meetings were very quiet, as it was said, about the proposed route coming through the area. And a lot of it had to do with the fact this is, these kind of roads on this kind of scale had never been done before. And there's lots of new things going on. The building of the roads themselves becomes a bit of an experiment. There's one segment of near Burniston that was laid with concrete, because they had to originally go back in and dig all back out because they didn't. We've got to have a picture of that. But this is a new thing. Nothing on this scale has ever been done, and no one quite knows how to prepare for it. So I want to show you, this is it. The whole run is 291 miles, 58 miles through Connecticut, 55 miles through Massachusetts, and 177.6 miles through Vermont. Construction started in late 58, although it was stopped almost immediately. Again, there were concerns about a local building. And it would continue up to 1970. The segment through our area here, that is from, say, the Vermont border all the way down to Northampton, was completed by 1966. The last segment completed, as everyone knew, was going to be Springfield. The idea was to start north and come down. They didn't entirely do that. But Springfield was waiting until the last part because everyone knew it was going to be a nightmare. And it turned out to be an incredible nightmare. This is one of the first drawings I found. This, again, is coming from, you can see here, the guys losing their fishing holes here. Falls River relocation, right down through there. This is one of the earliest drawings that I have found, showing the road. But I love artistic renderings. Have you noticed there are never any hitchhikers on those? There are never any car wrecks. There's never any road repair closings on an artist's rendering. Now that's a little more stark, isn't it? This is the border of Vermont and Massachusetts. Now Vermont has completed its segment. It's still under construction, actually, but you can see where the border is. Right there. And I'm going to read you this headline, too, underneath here. Wide High Road to Nowhere. That's a lot starker look at what happens, isn't it? I can show you all kinds of pictures and drawings of what's going to happen when a road comes through your area. That's the truth. That's what happens. It plows through. I want to share a quote with you A documentary was done a couple of years ago called Divided Highway, based on a book by Tom Lewis. And he has a really powerful quote. One of the historians on the documentary says this. His name is William Cronin. The interstates gash their way through existing rural landscapes and farming communities, small towns, and in many cases it just destroys them. You drive down the interstates passing through farms which were old family farms going back to the 19th century. And the farmhouse is on your left, and half the fields are on your right, and the farm family that now has its land split in that way, if it keeps that land at all, has to commute 2 or 3 miles with its tractor to get to the other side of the highway to keep the farming its land. This is a ripping asunder of old relationships that were present in the landscape, and there's a kind of shattering of community that comes with that. And that is something that often was learned in the act of doing, because so much of this was not really understood until the construction of these things began. Now this is an aerial view, again, of the border. You can see here the road coming through there and stopping dead right there, and this is the border. The first segment, it's really kind of odd. The first segment's complete on 91 with the tip ends of it. About 2 miles here from the border, the Vermont border, going down to where 10 crosses in Berniston. And then the little tip down in Longmeadow coming up to the end of Springfield, to the border for us, the town of Springfield. Those two little tips were the first ones that were done. And then they began filling it in as they progressed. This next picture, this was from the recorder. This is looking north, and the road is coming here. The road stops here. This is the construction, and this is Greenfield, coming into Greenfield here. And again, you have the drawing of the lines across it. The big kind of big aerial photographs began to be shown now, too, because people wanted to kind of place themselves in context of what was going on here. And so I have something I want to share here. I just got this yesterday. This picture and the next one were provided for me. It was taken by James Raymond, and his son Bob Raymond contacted me and said he had a couple of aerial shots of early days of the construction of it, too. And so I wanted to thank him, and also Rick Cernak, who provided these pictures for me, these next couple of ones I want to show you. Again, too, it's just, you can see the beginning construction here. And with the farm here, I think it's to me, these pictures are fascinating because they show both the rural land and then the area being cleared out for the interstates to come through. Man, it says something too, the early writings about the highway, they called it the double-barreled superhighway. And the argument of progress runs through all of this. All along, the big argument is that the highways are safer. I'll talk more about this as I progress. But the idea of the highways being safer, the gap between 91, the 100-foot gap between the north and southbound, that's there because of so many fatal accidents on two-lane roads. Head-to-head collisions were so awful in the early days, and so the gap between the road, it was considered to be much safer, and it would keep glare down as well. And you can see the road coming through here. This next picture, which looks a little rough, but I wanted to use it because it shows the embankment being built up here. Coming through. And I think these are from between Deerfield and Northampton, is my understanding. I was on the map today trying to place exactly where some of these were. So I want to show you some of the other construction that's going on. This is looking toward Greenfield from Whately North, and again, you can see the kind of tearing that happens here of opening these kind of things up. And often land is raked in from the outsides. The Emerson Tree Farm outside of Greenfield, I was talking to her, and she said that they had 100, when they bought the farm, there were about 50 acres of it down along 91 that had never been planted with Christmas trees. And so they decided that they would do that. It's just sitting there. And so they planted 100 trees there. And when they came up, they were stunted, and they couldn't sell them because they looked so awful. And when they did a check of the soil, they found out that all the topsoil was completely gone. It had all been raked off to create the highway that runs by there. And here, 50 years later, you know, nothing decent is going to grow there. The kind of long-term effect of this kind of thing. Other parts of the state that are beginning to be done, here's another one. Aerial photos show state plans. This is down south of Springfield. The highway is going to come slicing right through here. Nothing's been done yet. This right here is the first big controversy over the building of I-91. This is the Barney Estates. This is Forest Park right here. And so there was a huge complaint about the destruction of the Barney Estates, which was an important part of the community. And so they got an injunction that actually stopped construction. It's just getting started in late 58. This is December of 58. And an injunction stops production, stops the grading of the road. And it lasted for 2 months before they eventually got it worked out a little bit. But I think it's interesting that right as the road's getting started, people are jumping up and saying, wait a minute, you can't do this. Eventually, this building was torn down completely and never replaced, and the road sliced up through the edge of there. It took 50 acres of Forest Park. I'm going to share some statistics with you. Get my right page. This is what it takes to build 1 mile of interstate road. 15 to 40 acres of land, 40,000 cubic yards of rock, earth, and peat, 30,000 cubic yards of gravel, 5,000 tons of crushed stone, 5,000 cubic yards of cement, 25,000 square yards of steel to reinforce pavement, 4,000 foot of guardrail, and 7,000 feet of stock fence to create 1 mile of interstate. This is construction again coming south, in the south coming north. Actually, we're looking north here. This again is the Barney Estate right here. A big exchange will be built right there, the big triple decker as they always called it. One of the reasons for the building of the interstate system early on had to do with the idea of defense for the country. Now this bounces back and forth. There's all kinds of myths about this. My favorite is called the 1 in 5 myth, the idea that for every 5 miles of interstate, there had to be 1 mile that was absolutely straight so that military aircraft could land on it. Another thing that was put down when the roads initially began was the idea that all the overpasses had to be 14 feet high. This would allow any military machine, trucks or machinery to go under them. Well, they had built 2 overpasses, one here in Long Meadow and one up in Burniston. When someone put an ICBM on a flatbed truck and discovered it was 16 feet tall. And so all the bridges that had been built to them had to be adjusted. So they went 2 feet down here to make it 16 feet. Now, they didn't always do that. I've heard of a road in Michigan that they used hydraulic jacks and lifted the bridge up 2 feet to make sure it had the 16-foot clear. So I'll talk a little more about the military aspects of the road. But it was called the $1.5 billion error. And another indication, too, that initially in the first years of building of these highways, there was a lot of hit and miss. There was a lot of experimentation. The road coming down from Vermont was 400 feet wide. The road that was going to be coming from Massachusetts was 300 feet wide. So they had to work all those kind of things out. You know the posters you see of the out west of the trains, of the one track going this way and one track coming like that? That happened to some extent here too, because 91, of course, when it comes into the state, is on the east side of the Connecticut River. The rest of the interstate that's being built is on the west side. And so that had to be a controversy right off the bat. And the great big curve you have in Springfield swing you back over is to get you back on the other side of the road, because all of that road coming down on the western side had already been completed. Which brings me to one of my favorite stories. Okay, I love this. I want to talk about the building of the highway system. But of course, roads really are there for us to ride around on our cars, because Americans love their cars. Let me tell you one of my favorite stories. This is a shot from The Grapes of Wrath, released in 1940 by Paramount, a famous movie, won Academy Awards, based on the novel by John Steinbeck, The Grapes of Wrath, published in 1939, won the Pulitzer Prize. You know the story, right? They're kicked off their farm. They hop on a bunch of old beat-up cars and jalopies. They take Route 66. They're Okies. There's your jalopy. They go into California to try to make a new start. When the movie was released in 1940, a copy of it made its way to the Soviet Union. And the Soviet officials watched the movie The Grapes of Wrath, and they loved it. Oh, this is great. Bankers throwing people off their land, people piling up into old beat-up vehicles, going to another part of the country where they're thrown in government camps. It's perfect. So they decide they're going to show the movie as anti-American propaganda in a number of theaters around Moscow. So it shows there over the course of a weekend. And thousands of people go to see it. And when they come out, the Russian people all say the same thing. Oh my gosh, look at that. In America, no matter how poor you are, everybody has a car. What a wonderful country it must be. So the Soviet officials realize they made a disastrous mistake. They pulled the movie from all the theaters, and that's the story of the short but rather glorious run of The Grapes of Wrath in the Soviet Union. And yet, if I was to tell you to pick an image of the American dream, you can't beat that, can you? It's all there. Movement, travel, going somewhere new, getting the family together, celebrating freedom. It's all right there. We love our cars. And so the history of highways is a history of cars. But it didn't start with cars. I love the fact that the two greatest technological inventions that changed the world in the 20th century, the automobile and the airplane, both came out of bicycles. And bicycle people were the first ones to clamor for better roads. The first magazine devoted to roads, called Good Roads in America, published by a bicycle. And so the idea of getting on something and go, because these bicycle shops very soon transformed into automotive shops. In 2003, Ken Burns did a movie called Horatio's Drive. And this was the story of Horatio Nelson Jackson, who in 1903, on a $50 bet, how American is that, said that he could drive his 2003 cherry red Winton from San Francisco to New York City. And he proceeded to do exactly that, 100 years after the Lewis and Clark expedition was going the other way. It takes him 62 days, and a lot of people are thinking, well, okay, that's not going to beat the train. But he was the first person to do it, and he showed what a car could do. The problem, of course, is when he made the trip, there were 150 paved miles of road. Everything else was that. And the jalopy. And this will be the story of roads and cars. The cars will get faster, and they'll get cheaper, but the roads, or the technology for roads, falls farther and farther behind. The first attempt to create a road all the way across the country was called the Lincoln Highway. It was built to go, again, from New York all the way to San Francisco. The idea was to be there in time for the 1915 San Francisco World's Fair, which they did complete it. And it says something about the age and the era that most people thought, well, you know, one road would probably be enough to get everyone across the country who wants to go. So they did complete it, and there are still parts of the Lincoln Highway. It's subsumed into other highways now, but you can still travel that road. 1919. This is called the 1919 Military Convoy. The U.S. government decided it was time to travel around the country to test out some of this material that they have evolved. This is right at the end of World War I. So they decide they're going to do a great big military journey. 72 vehicles, 260 soldiers, 35 officers, and a 15-piece band. And they're going to travel all the way across America with all of this, and it's a nightmare. An absolute nightmare. One day, 7 bridges collapsed under them. One of the officials on it said, you know, on a good day, we made 5 miles a day, and there were never any good days. The 1.7 trucks all slid off the road all together, and took them 3 days to pull it all back out. It was an absolute disaster. But one of the lieutenants, a second lieutenant on that voyage, wrote a report about it. He said, this is awful. This trip was terrible. There is no way to get across the country efficiently or well. Something has got to be done. And that second lieutenant's name was Dwight David Eisenhower. And he will have a chance later on to do something about that. So by the 1920s, cars are everywhere. By the end of the 1920s, there's one car for every four people in the country. The first enclosed car goes on the market in 1922. People loved it. You could be out there at any time. By the end of the 1920s, there's one car every 6 seconds rolling out of the factory. That's the good news. The bad news is about once every 15 minutes, someone is dying in them because they're extremely dangerous. They're big and heavy and hard to control. When they get out of control, they stay out of control. But the car, as a thing that you own that establishes your identity, your place in the culture, is beginning to kick in by the 1920s. Think of this, The Great Gatsby. I love this cover, too, because the cover is kind of a viewpoint through a dash, isn't it? Think of how important cars are in that. Babbitt, another novel from the 1920s, loved his car. The traveling salesman as a character emerges at this time, as a character in stories. The first cartoon's about being on the road. The first cartoon of the boyfriend saying, "Oh, honey, it looks like we're out of gas." Those begin to appear in the 1920s. Life is happening in the car. More and more people want them. They're getting cheaper. But the problem is still roads. But all that begins to start to change, first of all, with the WPA. The worst project, which got so many people out, $1.8 billion go into building roads and bridges. For the first time ever, there's a concerted effort to create a road system through America. And one of the people who really pushed for this was Franklin Roosevelt. You know why? Because Franklin loved to drive. The first driving president. Had his first car in 1908. When he had polio in 1921, he had his old Model T retrofitted with knobs so he could continue to drive it. He had a Packard when he was president, and whenever he could get away from the White House, he would go riding around. He was, by all accounts, an unspeakably bad driver, and nobody would ride with him. Winston Churchill said, "I will never get in a car that Franklin's driving." But he loved cars, and he was the first one to come up with a real national system. He thought we should have 6 toll roads going across the country. He thought that should probably. Of course, that's not enough, but in 1944, you get the first real Financial Aid Act to build a highway system. The problem, of course, is 1944, the war is going on. Car manufacturing has plummeted. All factories are being retooled to build helicopters and airplanes and stuff like that. But the idea of a national system begins to emerge, that there needs to be a system that is connecting all of this. Now, World War II will be one of the things that shifts that around as it comes up. Futurama! Oh, okay, not that Futurama. This Futurama. This is a ride from the 1939 World's Fair. You got in these giant cars that floated over a huge landscape. 36,000 square acres, feet. It had 500,000 specifically designed houses on it. There were 10-foot tall skyscrapers. It was a 15-minute ride, and it showed you, here you can see there, they're looking on the end. I'll show this next picture, which is better. You can see off here to the right, you can see the city. This was a vision of what America was going to look like in the magical future year of 1960. It was going to be a world of interstate, big highways and big tall scrapers. They had 10,000 little cars on this that traveled around and moved. And people loved it. It was the future. This is what it looked like. And what's also eerie is an earlier movie. This is a movie called Things to Come from 1936. But look at the idea of the future city there. It's in the air. The idea that this is what the future is going to look like. It's going to look like this. It's going to have big highways and gigantic buildings. I have seen the future. This is the motto of the 39 World's Fair. And you know what? It looks like that's really what's going to happen. Because the fair ended, and in December of 1939, something opens up that does indeed look like it's going to be that kind of future. And they call it the Pennsylvania Turnpike. 160 miles. This is the template of the interstate. What was called, and I love this, the townless highway. The idea was it would get you from one place to the other, not necessarily from one town to the other, but you could travel without having to get off. You could travel. The original Pennsylvania Turnpike had no speed limit. Sometimes you'll hear people say that Eisenhower saw the autobahns in Germany and got the idea for the interstate system. Actually, the engineers for the Pennsylvania Turnpike traveled to Germany to watch the autobahns being built and got the idea for them. And that's one reason why, originally, on the turnpike, there was no speed limit. But everything is here. The idea of the exit, getting off to get gas. Howard Johnson's gets its start along here, 28 flavors of ice cream. The idea of getting on one of these roads and making a long trip and getting off begins to be the template for what's going to become the interstate system. Which brings us to the fabulous 50s. If you want to know more about this, there's a terrific book by Earl Swift called The Big Road. But I want to quote you what he says here about the 50s, because the 50s in some ways is the golden age of the car. Americans loved everything about their cars. They loved driving, loved that they could follow an impulse to go wherever they chose without a thought to routes or timetables. They loved that they lorded over their surroundings while they did it. They were cocooned, protected from the world. They could ride in silence or with the radio blaring, and he'd never surrender personal space to a sweaty, foul-smelling stranger. They thrilled to the sensation and sound of movement, the buffet of air through an open window, the big engine's growl and punch. What was it to love about the car? Americans took to it not only willingly, but with gusto. Not only did they love their cars, they wanted to do everything in their car. Family portraits done in the car. Dinner done in the car. Entertainment done in the car. You never have to leave your car. Everything can be done there. You can see the kind of idea of America on the move that's being promoted here. Everything can be done with your car. And of course you have to have a car. Everyone has to have a car. Two or three if you can do it. And so the idea of the car being a central part of your identity as an American anchors in really hard in the 1950s. And we also get this, because the early roads are not able to handle some of these early, the first real tangling up of cars, and the problem of so many people on the roads stacking up begins to emerge. Also, as the highway system begins to be built in the mid-60s, the first reports about environmental concerns begin to come up. Exactly what is happening to the air with all these vehicles being on the road. So all of that begins to emerge as the highways are being built. Which brings us to Eisenhower. Eisenhower signs in the 1954, the Financial Aid Highway Act, which basically says that the government is going to do the major part of building these roads. The earlier plans had called for a kind of halfway thing, that the government would pay 50% of the building of the roads and the states would pay 50%. That went nowhere. And so the government said, well, we'll pay 60% of it, and the states will pay 40% of it. And that went nowhere. The 1954 bill says that the government pays 90% of the highway, and the states will pay 10% of it, and they will be in charge of the roads. They'll be able to pick the speed limits, and they'll be responsible for the upkeep of the roads. But the actual building of them will be financed 90% by the government. This is what God had built. And so all of this begins in 58, 59. The segments up here were completed. The first segment was from the border of Vermont border down to 10 there in Berniston, and then from Greenfield up to 10. And then the segment, I believe, from Northampton, which was completed in 60, and then Northampton up to this part, up to Greenfield here was the last, this area was completed in 1966, and then the entire road was completed by 1970. So it took 12 years to build all of it, which was much longer than anyone expected, and I'll talk a little about that. But also, too, you can see this is part of the grid. The highway system is an attempt to put a grid on something that doesn't really want a grid on it. But you can see this in looking at the numbers at the bottom, south to north, it goes 10, 20, 30, 40, there's no 50, 70, 80, 90. And then from west to east in fives, you have 5, 15, 25, 35. Then 75, 85, 95. The idea was to have an actual organized grid of roads that would cover all possible ideas. The highway system was going to connect the country. It was going to connect the cities. But there were other concerns as well. These are the years of the Cold War. And one of the issues that was faced the military and the government was in the event of a nuclear strike, particularly at a major city, these cities with populations of 300, 400, 500,000 people or more, how are you going to get them out? How are you going to get people out of the city? So one of the reasons for the interstates, certainly the ones going through the city, was as evacuation. That's something that's kind of going on. We are in the Cold War as this is all being put together, and that becomes a factor as well. And then we get that, right? There's a cartoon here that I think is really cool, and I'll read you what it says. There we go. And the cartoon bubble over the top says, "And yet traffic still seems not to be moving. With Canada and Mexico, we could add a few more lanes in each direction." And then down at the bottom is a little lost car saying, "Where was it we were going?" The idea of the interstates taking over is another concern, too. I want to read you another passage. This is from a book that came out in 1962. It's very popular. People don't always think of it in the context. I want to put it in a slightly different context for you. It's called Travels with Charlie by John Steinbeck, one of the great American travel books. But he made this trip in the early 60s. The book came out in 1962. And he's traveling both small roads and big roads. But he's the first account, though, we really have of someone traveling on these roads and writing about it. And I want to share with you what he, in one segment he got on, I believe it was I-90. And so this is John Steinbeck from Travel with Charlie. "The minimum speed on this road was greater than any I had previously driven. I drove into a wind quartering in from my starboard bow and felt the buffeting, sometimes staggering blows of the gale I helped to make. Instructions screamed at me from the road, 'Do not stop, no stopping, maintain speed.' Trucks as long as freighters went roaring by, delivering a wind like a blow of a fist. These great roads are wonderful for moving goods, but not for inspection of the countryside. You are bound to the wheel and your eyes to the car ahead, and to the rearview mirror to the car behind, and the side mirror for the car or the truck that's about to pass. And at the same time, you must read all the signs for fear you may miss some instructions or orders. No roadside stands telling squash juice, no antique stores, no farm products or factory outlets. When we get these throughways across the whole country, as we will and must," 1962 he's writing this, When this is done, it will be possible to drive from New York to California without seeing a single thing." Which brings me to cars. There's a movie. I did this program in Shelburne a couple of weeks ago, and I put this car up, and there were three or four little kids in the audience, and they went berserk. Why am I talking about a Disney movie? Because it's a Disney movie about what happens when a road comes through. The story here is of these cars in this little community that gets slapped aside when the big highway comes through. But what's striking about it is that there's a kind of nostalgic moment where the cars recall what it was like to just get in your car and go for a drive. And every time I think about this, I think, you know, we get caught up in the big, loud, smelly roads and the smelly cars, you know, and the fumes that are killing us. But how many of you remember the Sunday drive? Right? Yeah. We go to church, then we go to dinner, and then Dad would say, "Well, let's go for a ride." And we'd all pile in the car, and we usually always went to where Dad wanted to go, which in my case was mobile home sale lots. There is a lot about the South that I just cannot explain. But at the top of the list is the love of mobile homes. And these lots, which were huge, and it was a big deal, and we would do this every Sunday. We would go here, and we would get out, and then they all these mobile homes, and you walk through them to look how the other half lives. And we would do it for hours. There would be lines to get up into them, to walk through them. And so we would do that every Sunday. But the idea, you know, of the car, again, being the kind of family time. If you think about it, The car is the only thing that pulled you together anymore. They're not around for the meals. They're off with their friends of an evening, or they're off doing their homework. The car is the only thing that pulls you together. Which brings me, not quite directly, back to 91 and the building of our road. This is a segment right south of Deerfield. See anything ominous in that visual?
Survey sticker.
Yeah, the sticker there. Survey sticker. This is from a farm right up near the Vermont border, Vermont, Massachusetts. I was doing this program in Berniston. And a woman said, you should go talk to Alan Pratt. Alan Pratt was here, and they built a road right through his back farm. And so I went and talked to him, you know, and I'm not a reporter, but I'm trying to fake it. You know, I'm sitting there. Yeah, okay, so what happened then? And finally he said, would you like to see some pictures? I said, I would love to see some pictures. And I was like, you've got pictures of this. He said, oh, I photographed the whole building of the road. And no one has seen these pictures. They were just things he had done for his family. So the next couple of pictures I'm going to show you are from this great cache of pictures that was passed on to me by Alan Pratt. And this is the first one. And this is his son playing in their backyard. And that's exactly right. You've got right there the first indicator that is where the highway's coming. I love this. This is a dog sled going across the finished part of the road. I have discovered, and I'm sure you have these stories too, that if you flatten out a big, long stretch of road and pave it and there's no cars in it, there's all kinds of things you can do on that. People get on it with their bikes. People get on it with their horses. And I love this picture of dog sled going across too. And drag racing, you know, another big thing. Explosions. A lot of people remember explosions of the road being built. A guy, this was probably somewhere south of Deerfield. He told me, I'm south of Greenfield. He told me he remembers the explosions and then the raining of the rock coming down on the roof of the house whenever they were doing it. But he loved that. And this is a photograph of the great roller skate opening. When the segment of the road was opened from Greenfield going up to 10, the crossing of 10 in Berniston, they opened the road with a roller skating contest. And this is the only photograph I have ever been able to find. And so yeah, this is cool. And here they're gathering around for the speech. There's always a speech at the opening. I want to read you. This is Fred B. Dole. Not to mention him. He was the associate commissioner for the state public works. Because he was from Shelburne, he was very prominent. It was felt that he was a kind of local voice here. So he had to deal, both good and bad, with the people who were upset about everything. But he gave a speech on the opening of this segment of the road. And I want to read this to you because it's actually really good. As this section of Interstate 91 is dedicated today, I can't help but think how we have shortened distances. My father used to tell about the high-wheel bike trips he took as a boy. It was an all-day arduous trek to Brattleboro over sandy dirt roads. As towns and cities are brought closer together, our whole way of life changes. There will be changes and new growth. Many people have remarked on the unusual beauty of the completed section of this highway. Let us all hope that we shall continue to think in terms of a highway of beauty, convenience, and comfort, and not a slaughterway of terror. A reminder of how dangerous these roads are. And I will tell you, as someone who has trolled through page after page and microfiche after microfiche of papers from the 1940s and 50s, there were dangerous roads. There were wrecks almost every day reported in the newspaper, and often they were very bad. The cars from this era are big and hard to control and heavy. And so wrecks were often very bad. Even if it was just a small fender bender going off in a ditch, could be a fatal thing. So one of the arguments made for the interstate system as a whole is that it would be safer. That it would get you on better maintained roads. It would have clearer sight lines. You would be able to do it. The roads themselves are designed for long travel as well. The up and down and left and right and up and down and left. That's all designed in the interstate system to keep the roads from being monotonous until you get out west where they quit bothering and they're just straight. But the idea that the interstate system is not only going to make things more convenient, it's going to interconnect towns, it's going to open up new markets, it means you're going to be able to get whatever you make, whatever product you're working on or your farm stuff is going to be better. So I have a couple of pictures I want to show you from the construction of the biggest project was the big elevated segment coming through Springfield. It was a hugely ambitious thing to do. Here you have the artist's conception of what it's going to look like and what it's going and the section that where it's coming through. They ran into a huge snag in building this road that had nothing to do with the highway. It had to do with war. Because in the 1967-68, the Vietnam War refunneled money so that money that was going to go into the highway system went into the war effort. And so that resulted in the last segment of the interstate that came in through Springfield, taking a long time to get built. But here you can see the building up of the elevation there. That's a great picture. And here's another good one coming through. It was a huge, ambitious thing to do, to take the road up like that. And the idea is to take when you have a main road coming through a place where there's already roads and exit of town, there's two things you can do. You can go over and you can go under it. And they did both up right outside of Springfield. They went under the roads coming into town, and then they went over them. The idea is you elevate it up, you can keep all the local roads running underneath you. Ideally, this will not have such a negative impact. It will not create a limited access road by going up and over everything. The local traffic can still continue on. But during the construction of the roads, it could be awful. This is after they had all opened up down there, and I love this headline. Autos go round and round, come out everywhere. So, and that's true, it was often hugely confusing, all these new types of roads. The curves, you would exit off and go in the direction you didn't want to be going. Yeah. Lots of stories about that. I just stumbled across this and wanted to add that this is a painting by Edward Hopper. And it's really, really great because the name of the painting is Four Lane Road. But of course, there's no four lane road in this picture. This is the little gas station attendant with the Harrigan wife bellowing out the window, apparently. Also, I'll tell you that Hopper and his wife did not get along. But I think it's a beautiful look at what has happened when the roads have shifted over. You know, this is a little interstate, a little gas station on a small two-lane road. And obviously, over that ridge there is the four-lane that has taken all of the business. But of course, you don't need just arts, it's just the renderings of that. Route 5 was really, really just devastated by the road, the loss. Because when you're the primary road, you know, you could have, there were gas stations every mile or two, garages, little places, courts to stay, small stands for food and fruits. All those things rely on lots of cars coming by. And when this is left behind, one of the things that the interstates did was introduce an ominous word to our traveling vocabulary, bypass. It becomes possible to just pass entire neighborhoods now. And that can be catastrophic. Or you can adapt. It's the four-leaf clover, which started out as a car hop business, right? All the cars come by, they go out and serve. Well, when 91 opened, the owner of the four-leaf decided he was going to switch to dining inside because he discovered an extraordinary thing. Once the interstates got up and running and people were on them a long time, they got sick to death being in the car. They got tired of the screaming kids in the back seat. They didn't want to eat in the car anymore. They wanted to go somewhere where they could get out of the damn thing and go sit down and have a meal. And so he switched the way his restaurant did its business. They quit doing the car hops. He opened up a dining room. And of course, they're here to this day. But it's a great example of how all the businesses had to adapt to this. You know, you had to have something that would make people want to get off the road and come to your place. And one of the things that could do that was air-conditioned dining would bring people in because people wanted to get out of the cars now. The 3 and 4 hour road trips that now become possible can also be grueling and awful with a bunch of screaming kids in particular. I know because I was a screaming kid in the back of my car. But that's how things change. This is a photograph of the leg of the concrete, which I think is just an extraordinary, the big inch. The roads took so much work, and it took years to make, and they changed everything. It's hard to really grasp sometimes how much stuff had changed, but I wanted to show you the different ways and the different stories that people had to tell about this. This is the tearing down of the Barney Estates. And this is the only photograph I've ever been able to find of this. But what I want to show you is right up here, you can see this statue. This is called the Three Graces. And the negotiation that was made to preserve is that they would keep that statue in place. And it is still there today. So some things stay, and some things just do not. Now, one of the reasons I began doing this program is because it has a personal interest to me, because the town I grew up in is gone. I grew up in a little town in North Carolina called McCaddenville. In 1994, my dad called me and he said, if you want to see the house you grew up in, you better go now. It's the last one slated to be pulled down. And the entire western half of my town, which was including almost seven streets and 150 houses altogether, was completely razed to bring in a new development. And the company that did this, and I'll never forget their name because it sounds like the name of a 1920s flapper. The company was called Saucy Burbank. And so they leveled everything out. And so my dad called, and he said, if you want to see the house you grew up in, you better go now because it's the last house there. Well, I thought he meant, you know, it was one way. So I go, and he's right. Our house is the last one standing. So there's these acres and acres and acres of nothing, and our house was left because it was at the end of the road. And so it was pulled down, ultimately, and everything was gone. And you know, that's always such a jolt, the way the landscape's taken away. You expect change. You know, I would have expected as I got older to go by that house, and it's got a new coat of painting, or there's a new swing set out there that's bigger than anyone we ever had. But you don't expect the trees in your front yard to be wrenched out of the ground, or the hill that you slid down to be leveled out. They re-landscape the whole area so that there's not a trace of it. And so that has made me very conscious of places that are taken away like that. The historian James Lowther, in one of his books, I believe it's Lies My Teacher Told Me, told a unique story about community memory. That there's a certain tribe in Africa that when someone in their community dies, they are not considered gone from the community. You are only gone from the community when the last person who knew you dies. You are kept there as long as someone remembers who you are. And I believe that that is very true of places as well. I think there's a part of them that survive as long as someone remembers them. This is North Parish. It was a place outside of Greenfield. You can see the construction here. There was a church, a community, and a pond that people loved to go ice skating. It was like the ice skating spot. And the whole thing was shifted away. They moved the church, and they moved two of the houses, but they filled in the pond. And so when I talk to people about, what do you remember about 91? One of the stories I often heard was Nashmill Pond. I remember Nashmill Pond. And the other one was this. Isn't that beautiful? You can't go there. This is the mill pond in the middle of Burniston. This is the exchange for 91 and 10 is where this was. I like to think there's a little bit of a revenge going on. When it rains a lot, there's a little puddle rises up in the middle of the highway. And it's the remnants of this. But you can't go there anymore. But a lot of people told me about how they were fishing there. And so when we talk about progress, It's important to remember that that does run all kinds of different directions, that there are things gained and that there are things lost. So whenever you go down to Springfield to go shopping or to go to the Baseball Hall of Fame, or if you go up to Brattleboro, or if you go somewhere and you sit down and you have an elaborate Chinese dinner, you know, think about the fact that the interstates make stuff like that possible because they interconnect us in all kinds of ways. But also, the next time you're driving on 91, and you look over and you see a clump of asparagus, as I have, on the side of the road, I want you to think about whose garden it might have been. Because that's what happens when the road comes through. Thank you. So that's my program about what I have learned. But what I would love to do, and I have done this for all the programs that I have done, I would love to take some time, and we have it, to hear from you. To hear stories from you, because y'all were here when a lot of this was going on. And one of the things I'm trying to do is an oral history project about all of this, compiling together stories. Ultimately, that I would like to do is some sort of book about the stories of the people's lives that were affected by this. So, thank you for coming out, but I would love to hear from you now.